this is really great that we have a turnout like this for a, such a technical meeting. It's really great. How many, this is your first mobile portal meeting? Amazing. Every time. So my name is Matt Gifford. I'm one of the organizers. So because we have so many new people every time, just go through some quick stuff about us. So obviously we're about mobile. We're the fourth Monday of the month, except for like at the end of the year, we'll talk about that. We're modeled kind of after Mobile Mondays, which you might be familiar with, but we're not actually affiliated with them. They will return to basics in fall. We have a website, mobileportland.com, Google group, which is for sort of general discussion. If you're looking for help for a project or you're hiring or something like that, that's where you go. We actually have a mailing list on mobileportland.com that is just basically two announcements a month about this meeting. We have a Twitter account at Mobile Portland, and we have an IRC account, but I'm not even going to bother to advertise anymore. If you're good enough to use IRC, then you'll probably find out. So there's actually not a whole lot to talk about. We don't have any events really coming up on our calendar right now other than the next meeting. So we're going to go straight into announcements. So if you have a job opening or looking for somebody to help with something or an event, just raise your hand and I'll come around.
Hi, I'm Dan. I work for the New Group, an agency located down in McAdam, and we are hiring Drupal developers, which I know it doesn't totally fit mobile, but if you happen to be cross-technical, that would be great, so I'd love to talk to you.
Hi, my name is Jack. I work at Planet Argon. I'm a front-end developer. We're actually going to be teaching a front-end workshop in a couple of months, early May, if anybody is interested. The website is modernwebworkshop.com. I came up with a promo code to save you guys 10% if you punch in Mobile Portland. Just teaching a bunch of front-end things. And it's for the next month. It's early bird pricing, too. So.
Thank you. My name is Shannon Mintel. I'm not here to talk about hiring, but we're looking for women mentors who are in engineering and mobile. We're working with a bunch of high school girls from inner city Portland, teaching them how to build mobile applications. And we are getting pretty far along, and we need some people to come in and do some judging of what the girls have done so far. And a female engineer would be awesome.
Very hard to find, so you know.
So if you know of one or you are one, please let us know. Java expertise, appreciated. Thank you.
I'm Dan Swanson. I work with 24/7. I'm a recruiter. We have an ongoing need for Android and iOS developers. I will be around at the end of the meeting. We'd love to talk with you.
Hi, I'm Michael Gray. I'm with Globetripa, a mobile ticketing company, and we are actually looking for a cloud services administrator to work back in for a mobile application, so Amazon Web Services in particular.
Hi, I'm Toby Stephenson. I work for Mobilitas. We run the world's largest mobile ticketing platform, and we're looking for front-end developers and designers for our new office.
Okay, so thanks to our sponsors, to Cloud4, they provide the food, and also the device lab. I want to talk about the device lab for a second. We have a device lab now, lots of stuff. If you look on the website, We have a list of devices that are available and a way to sign up for some time. If you have something that you need to test, you don't have to sneak into a phone shop anymore. You can actually come and check out the stuff at our office at Cloud 4. So be sure to check that out. We've had several people come by in the last couple months, and we've been really happy with it. So. And also thank you to Urban Airship, and I think Ms. Barlow is somewhere. I think she has something to say.
Or not. Hey, Barb. Hey,
Hunter. Did you want to?
I'm Barb Stark with Urban Airship. Everybody welcome. I hope you enjoy the beer and the evening and the great Google panel that we'll be presenting. We also have many jobs on our website that we're looking for all across the board, not only here, Chicago, Berlin, San Francisco, you name it. UrbanAirship.com/careers.
And they provide the great space and the beer. Great. So. So tonight is Make the Mobile Web Fast, so there's been a lot of emphasis on all these new languages like Node and Go and how to make things faster, and you know, you get better search engine ranking and happier people, especially on mobile where you've got, you know, flaky connections and that sort of stuff. A fast website is really great. So. We've got a couple of people from Google here. We've got Joshua Marantz and Ilya Grigorik here to talk to us about, oh, and Matthew is going to as well. Okay, and Matthew Steele to talk to us about how to do that.
The intent is not to just make Google services fast, although that's certainly one of our core goals, but also to make the entire web fast, because we know that, you know, the more people use the web, the better it is for Google in the long run. And we think it's a good thing to do. So we've invested a lot into tooling, infrastructure, open source projects, and all other things to speed up the web. And we'll talk about some of the open source projects that we have that may help you and your site to automate and make your sites faster without necessarily having to do all the work yourself, which is the way I like for this stuff to work. But first, I want to kind of position this talk as, imagine we have a goal, which is to say, we want to make the mobile web really fast. And by really fast, I mean make stuff visible on the screen within 1 second. Right? If that's our explicit goal, what would it take to make that happen? And as you'll see, that creates some really interesting implications for how we construct our pages. This is something that we started thinking about recently, more and more actively at Google. So before we get into the technical bits of how to do that, I want to talk about what is the impact? Oh, sorry, before I get into that, one quick question. As one of the things we'd like to do, we can also then take a look at specific sites and maybe give you some recommendations. Does anybody have any particular sites that they want to kind of throw out there for us to analyze later? Anybody courageous enough? Mike?
TheClimb.com.
TheClimb.com.
The
Anybody else? we'll start with that. If at any point you guys are curious, and we'll show you the tools as well, but we'll take a look at that. So first of all, before we get into technical bits, it's important to, I think, consider what is the implication of this, right? Like, what does it matter if my site is slow? As engineers, we like to make things fast. It's fun. You know, it's the kinds of things we like to show off. But really, does it actually translate to dollars and cents? Because ultimately, that's what the business people care about at the end of the day. So Google and Bing, actually, this was a collaborative study that we ran a couple of years back. And the idea was, if we make our pages slower, not faster, slower, explicitly slower, what's going to happen? Right? We just wanted to answer this question. So Google made, so we took a bucket of users, right, a subsection of users, and actually just made our pages return slower. And we explicitly controlled for, like, when does the page get slower? Is it before we return anything? Is it before we return some results, but then we don't display certain parts of it? Like, we just basically started, you know, changing the behavior of the page. And what we found was that after a couple of weeks, the users that were put into this bucket started performing fewer searches, right? And in fact, we measured it, and it was about 0.6%, which doesn't seem like a great deal, but when you actually multiply that out by the number of searches done on Google, this is a huge amount, right? This is equivalent to huge gains in search quality. So this performance was offsetting the number of searches. Bing did a similar study, and they varied slightly different things. And the things I'll point out is here, for example, they slowed down the page by 1 second, so this is the search result page, and the revenue per user dropped by 2.8%. When the page was slowed down by 2 seconds, the revenue per user dropped by 4.3%. So the revenue per user in that case is people clicking the ads on their pages, which is huge, that's significant, right? That's 5% revenue. And as you can see, it also corresponded to all the other metrics, like the satisfaction that users reported from visiting their page, etc. And then the one thing that's not reported in this data was that, and I think this is kind of a really interesting psychological result, was that once we removed these users from this slow bucket, right, all we returned them back to the fast experience after a couple of weeks, they didn't immediately go back to the old doing more searches behavior. It actually took them another couple of weeks to revert back. So you basically, we train users to react in a certain way, or interact, rather, with our page in a certain way based on the experience that we deliver.
This was desktop, not mobile?
Yes, so this was desktop. This was not for mobile specific. But these same numbers are even worse on mobile, actually, and we'll see that in a second. So, you know, that's Google and Bing. Another company called Torbit. Are you guys familiar with the concept of real user measurement, or ROM? So I see a few people shaking their head. So the idea here is, how do we actually know how well your site is performing, right? The best way to do that is to get data from real users accessing your site, which means that if they're using a specific mobile phone and a specific network, we want to know specific data for, like, how long did the TCP time, TCP connect time take, DNS time, and all these kind of bits and pieces. So ROM is a way to gather this data. More modern browsers allow you to actually grab this data out of the browser and send it to your analytics provider. So Torbit is one of these kind of commercial vendors that will do that. And what they've done here is they've taken all the data across all their customers, which is a couple of billion data points, and they basically said, look, if we increase the page load time, how does that affect bounce rate? And bounce rate is it's the act of you come to a page and then you immediately leave. You don't navigate anywhere else on your page. And they found that as the page load time increases, the bounce rate increases by 0.65% for every second day. So I'll show you this example right here. How many people here use Google Analytics? Lots of hands go up. How many people have a ROM solution? You're all wrong, because everybody that put up the Google Analytics, your head for Google Analytics, you already have ROM. So this is kind of an awesome tip for you guys. So this is just my own site. I'll just show you this very quickly. If you log into your Google Analytics account, if you scroll under Content Overview, or sorry, Content Site Speed, Google Analytics already gathers this ROM data for you. There are certain things you can do to make it better, like raise your sampling rate, but I'll show you this. I'm looking at my overview page here. And what it shows me here is the average page load time plus a bunch of other metrics that are performance metrics for my site. Now, a natural question to ask at this point is, like, well, great, you know, my average page load time is, let's say, 6 seconds, but how does, like,
how does that compare between desktop and mobile? And this is the power of Google Analytics, and other vendors will do this too, where you can go into something like an events segment, and you can say, well, I'm comparing my mobile traffic with desktop traffic. Or you can segment by continent, by country, by city level, whatever you want to do, right? And I click apply, and it'll show me a new graph that shows that, you know, the blue line is the mobile traffic, and desktop traffic is in the bottom. So as you would expect, mobile traffic is slower, right? By roughly by 3 seconds, actually, or 5 seconds. So this is actually a pretty huge gap. And you can see that there's a huge spike in here as well for mobile, for whatever reason. And we have tools where you can drill in and figure out why did that spike happen on mobile specifically, right? Desktop users weren't affected. So there's some outlier. So in any case, I'm not going to get into too much detail about this, but if you haven't, you can go back to Google Analytics account and play with this. The one tip I have is by default, for site speed data, we will sample only 1% of your traffic, but you can set that to be much higher. So you can actually set the sampling rate to be to 100%. So if you go in here and you don't find a lot of data, that's why. We're just not gathering enough. You can go into your Google Analytics settings or into your configuration and change that. So let's go back. So hopefully that provides some motivation for why do we care. Basically, we can tie performance down to real dollars and cents. And the question of what that correlation is for your site is really dependent on your own specific application, right? Whether you have an e-commerce site or you're gathering email signups, whatever that may be, try and correlate speed to one of those metrics. And so tools like Google Analytics and other analytics tools will provide you functionality to do that. So with that out of the way, the next question is like, so great, how are we doing today? First, let's set some baselines. There are great user studies out there that show that if you respond to a user action within 100 milliseconds, it appeals instantly. Users report it as being instant, right? Very fast. Within 250 milliseconds is the blink of an eye. And that's, to some degree, why most big sites like Amazon, Google, Bing, and others have this semi-official goal of all of our pages should return within 250 milliseconds or less, because that feels almost instantaneous to the user. Like you hit enter and you get a result right there, which is the experience that you want, because you keep the user engaged. Anything approaching 1 second, it really starts to feel like the machine is doing something, like it's thinking, right? And anything over that, chances are the user is doing a context switch. And we've all had this experience, right? You click the button, the thing starts spinning, and the next thing you know, you're thinking about that other email that you need to respond to. And then you forget what the heck you were doing in the first place. So ideally, right, you want to keep the user engaged and kind of singularly focused on the thing they're doing. You want to respond under 1 second to feel instant that needs to be done within 250 milliseconds. Right? That's kind of the baseline. That's the ideal world that we want to be. Where are we today? Well, it's not looking good at this point. Which is to say there's a lot of room for improvement, which is the good news. So we gathered this data through Google Analytics, right? This is the kind of the same data that I was showing you just now from my own site, but across all of our sample of the sites that we're gathering Google Analytics, like billions and billions of data points. This is as of April 2012, or May 2012, one of those two. And you can see that on desktop, the median time for loading the page, right, is about 3 seconds. I'm rounding up here. Whereas on mobile, it's 5 seconds. And this number, I put a star here, hard to see, because this data was gathered from the latest Android phones, which is to say you have the latest hardware, chances are you're in the latest network. So this is actually a very optimistic scenario. In reality, you can probably multiply this number by 2, and you'll get the right kind of margin of performance. So what this tells you is that an average user on the web today is getting a page load time of 5 seconds. Right? And our goal is 1 second or less. So we have to figure out how to shave off another 4 seconds in our pages, which is quite the challenge. So a natural question to ask at this point is like, why does it take us 5 seconds to render a page on mobile? And there's a great project called HCPArchive.org, which basically crawls the web and gathers analytics on how our page is constructed on the web today. So we don't care about the content of the pages, we just care about like how big is the page, how many resources, or JavaScript resources, or CSS resources, what is the size of all the CSS, etc. So this data plots, this graph rather, plots the data for over a period of a year. And you can see that, for example, the total file size of our pages is growing. So this is across thousands of the most popular mobile sites out there. An average page, mobile page today is about 700 kilobytes, which is pretty large, right? And you can see that about 490, or let's round that up and call it 500 kilobytes, half a megabyte of that is in images. So in fact, most of the bytes, more than 50% of the bytes of your average page are images, which immediately tells you something very important, which is if you're not very careful about optimizing your images, you should go back and really revisit that. Right? Are you using the best image format? Are you serving it in the right file size? All of these questions. And in fact, we do a lot of work on the PageSpeed side, which we'll talk about later, to help you do that and help you automate all these things. But you know, if nothing else, if you're not using PageSpeed, go back and make sure that you're serving your images correctly, because everything else is kind of much, much smaller. So second, you know, we're serving a lot of JavaScript, which shouldn't be surprising to a lot of you, but we're building increasingly more and more complex applications, not just pages. And then, you know, some CSS and HTML. So the other thing, the other trend that I think is very, very interesting is that for many people, increasingly mobile is the only way they experience the web, which is surprising to me, at least when I saw these numbers at first. For example, in the United States, out of the quarter of people that have mobile phones, that is their only way to access the web, right? Which is oftentimes, I think, the reason for complaints about downgrading the user experience, right? Downgrading the user experience for the mobile phones. Maybe you just don't give all the same flexibility on the site and all the rest. And that's why people want to go back to the desktop sites, because they just simply can't find all the utility in the mobile sites. So I think this is a really interesting and growing trend. You'll find more and more people kind of in this bucket. So at this point, you know, I've outlined why we care, kind of where we are, and you know, pages are growing, video is everywhere, big images of awesome cats, and you know, all that kind of fun stuff. But that's all cool because you know, the latest 4G network will save us, right? Like every banner on like every street is saying, you know, sign up for the latest 4G thing. It's going to save all things. And unfortunately, that is not the case. For a whole number of reasons. For example, I took this snippet directly out of the Sprint technical FAQ. So they're saying, like, if you sign up today on a 4G network, you will get throughput of about 3 to 6 megabits per second, which is actually pretty good. Like the bandwidth is good, but expect the average latency, which is the round trip time between you sending a request from your device to just the core network of the server, to be 150 milliseconds. So think about this for a second. To be instant, we need to be 100 milliseconds. But just sending the packet, right, back and forth is 150 milliseconds. This is without any data whatsoever, right, on a latest network. So that is a problem. And unfortunately, we have this, you know, speed of light problem. Like, we can't just make latency go away. So until we figure that one out, this is our limiting factor today. In fact, in many cases for mobile, especially for mobile, but even for desktop web today, it is not the bandwidth that's constraining the user. So whenever you hear somebody advertising or talking about the latest whatever network with more bandwidth, that is going to help your streaming video downloads of large files experience, but it's not going to make your pages load any faster because you have many small resources which need to be delivered in these round trips. So thinking about how you deliver those resources is very, very important. And you know, the story only gets worse for 3G networks and lower, like 400 milliseconds for 3G, so basically half a second, right, for a 3G network. And I guess the other trend that I'll point out is, while we like to all dream about the 4G world, the truth of the matter is 3G networks are not going away for another decade. They will be around, people will be using them, and your phone will be switching continuously between 4G and 3G. Right, so while we may be lucky enough here to have the latest 4G or whatnot network, that is not the case for a lot of users. So 4G is not going to save that place, unfortunately. So I already mentioned some of the stuff, but you know, just to drive the point home, like the life of a, this is kind of getting into more technical bits, the life of a request on the web, whether that's in your browser or your native application delivered over HTTP, first we need to, you give us a URL, right? Like, I need to fetch this awesome package, please. And you say, okay, well, I have no idea what this host name is, right? So I'm going to look up that, resolve that name to an IP address. That will take, you know, I'm picking an arbitrary number here, which is like I picked an average between 4G and 3G of 250 milliseconds. Let's just assume that the round trip time is 250 milliseconds. So we do that. That takes 250 milliseconds. Then we need to do a TCP connection, or establish a TCP connection, which is another round trip. So 250 milliseconds. Then we actually, once we connected, we need to send the request for the, you know, give me the awesome cat image, please. You need to render that image and send it back to me, right? So if you just add up the network latency in here, without any of the actual smarts of what your application is doing and generating the HTML and all the rest, we're already looking at 750 milliseconds of just network time, right? Which means that if you want your pages to be visible like under 1 second or within 1 second, you really have like a budget of 200 milliseconds in here to get all of your work done, which is a fun little challenge. So, you know, this is basically what I just said. You know, you take into account all the network time. We have 250 milliseconds. So really what you should be thinking about is, if I have a budget of, let's say, 250 milliseconds to get my pages visible as quickly as possible, you know, it is reasonable to expect that, you know, maybe I can render all of my content in about 100 milliseconds or less. So this, you know, for people that are working on the back end, this is kind of your target, and make it as fast as possible. And then you also have to allocate time for the browser to render the page, right? Because the pages today are complicated. We have HTML, we need to build the CSS, we need to build kind of this visual hierarchy, visual tree, paint it to the screen. There's a ton of work that's going on here, and that takes a lot of time. So 150 milliseconds, if anything, you should err on the side of dedicating more time to render the page than to deliver the page. So fast backend time absolutely matters, but that 150 milliseconds is also critical, because this number should tell you something very important. Because our round trip time is 250 milliseconds, you can't make any other request. Right? Like, if you make another request for a CSS file, you're already over the budget. You can't make another request for a JavaScript file. So basically, you need to deliver the whole like visual experience in one shot and render it. That is your only way to get under 1 second, which is kind of interesting. And you know, that's counter to how we think about the web today, because even for the mobile web, an average page today consists of 60 requests. These are images, CSS, JavaScript, and other things, right? You just can't make 60 round trips in 1 second. That would defeat the laws of physics, unfortunately, at this point. The climb.com has 93 requests. So.
That's better, right?
Yes, you win at the moment. So this is kind of an interesting thing. So this is a thinking process that we're also going through at Google. We don't have all the answers right now, but this is something that we're realizing when we're building our pages and our applications, that, hey, we don't actually have all this much time. So the kind of the two rules that we have at this point is, if we do want to make the page visible in under 1 second to deliver that instant experience to keep the user engaged, we can't make any extra requests. We need to deliver the HTML, and we need to inline a lot of the content such that the user doesn't have to make any requests. And then after that, we need to deliver incrementally things that were after you render the about default kind of thing. We have this term, I guess, that we're using now, which is time to glass, which is to say, how long did it take to paint something to the screen? Right? There's a big difference between two pages, which both of which take 5 seconds to load, one of which is blank for 4.9 seconds, and then paints the whole thing, versus something that paints incrementally, like 1 second, 2 second, 3 second, 4 seconds. Right? Very different visual experience for the user, and users prefer that kind of enhanced view as opposed to just a blank screen. So that is what we mean by kind of this 1 second. It's not to say that you should, you know, all of a sudden delete all your JavaScript and CSS and go back to, you know, plain text files. That would solve the problem, but you know, probably not the solution that we're looking for. But rather to figure out, like, what are the critical elements of my page that I need to get visible immediately, and then what can I deliver after the fact, after I render this like above default content, to make the rest of the application function. So here's an example. This is a very simple example, which is a very simple page. Chances are you have something like this in your markup today. Right? You have a style sheet and you have a JavaScript file. And this actually, this is almost best practices. You know, we can argue about maybe the script should be at the bottom of the page. But this is a pretty reasonable implementation, except that we've already shown that this wouldn't really work for the 1 second scenario because the latencies would just kill it. So really, what, you know, what we're saying here is what we need to do is to say, sorry, that's getting cut off a little bit. First, we need to figure out what are the critical pieces of the full content of CSS that I can just inline into the page, right? So I'm gonna write out these styles right here. And then similarly for scripts, it turns out that for most scripts that you include on a page, they're not even critical, right? Most of the time we use scripts for enhancing the experience, which is to say the layout of the page happens, and then we add additional functionality through JavaScript to the page. But that is not necessary to render the page. When the JavaScript is at the top, it will block, so here, it will block all rendering of the page until this file is loaded and executed. If you hide it, if you load it later, you can paint this, you can paint the content much, much quicker. So that's basically what we're doing here. We're saying, inline the stuff that you need, inline the stuff that you need, and then way after, right, perhaps through JavaScript, you say, after I painted this thing, after the onloaded that fires in my browser, let me load the rest. That is really the only way that you can get to that 1 second goal. And one of the things we did on our team is we actually tried to look at some of the most popular sites, big sites, mobile sites out there, and see if we could actually apply this. And it turns out that we can. We can actually make this work. It definitely requires some careful engineering, kind of thinking about how your code is structured. But we have shown that we can, in fact, this is probably the good best practice moving forward. Render something progressively and fill in the rest. So, this is just a summary of everything I think that I just said, which is JavaScript is bad because it blocks the way that the page is constructed. Right? This is just an inherent property of how JavaScript interacts with the construction of the object model. Then there's this funny dependency, which is JavaScript can query your CSS for styles, right? So it can block on CSS. So you want to get the CSS down to the user as quickly as you can, which is why we have this rule for put CSS at the top. CSS is the most critical thing. If you think about it, it makes perfect sense. We can't paint anything to the screen until we have all the visual styles, right? If we were to paint something without the visual styles, it would mean that we would render the unstyled content. And then all of a sudden, sometime later, we would like repaint everything and everything's styled. I'm sure you guys have seen that sometimes, when your connection is flaky. Terrible experience. We don't do that, so we have to wait for all the CSS. We block on it, we parse it, and then we go forward. So there's this funny dependency, CSS at the top, JavaScript. That's it.
What about jQuery mobile? How do you feel about where that should go?
So jQuery mobile, it depends on, once again, how your site is structured. jQuery mobile is much heavier in how this page is constructed, right? Like jQuery mobile, to some degree, constructs the page, as opposed to enhances the page. So there you may not be able to get away with just querying JavaScript. So you just have to start looking at, can I inline some of the parts that make sense? jQuery mobile is pretty large. So there are trade-offs here. Yeah. So I don't think there's a good answer for that. But we don't have a good answer for that yet. So at this point, I'm actually going to hand over to Josh to talk about PageSpeed. So PageSpeed is a family of projects that we have at Google, which are both analysis and optimization. We have analysis. Are people here familiar with PageSpeed at all?
No.
So if you have used, anybody here use Chrome, Google Chrome? Okay. Go to the Chrome Web Store and search for PageSpeed Insights. It's an extension that gets installed into your developer tools. And then, So I'll just pick on this guy from CNN. So I have this extension installed called PageSpeed Insights, right? And what it's going to do is, I say start analyzing, and it'll reload the page, and it'll analyze how the page is constructed. And give me recommendations for what can I do to make this page faster. So we have a set of rules, right? And you can see that we prioritize them in order, high priority, low priority, or medium priority. So for example, leverage browser caching. So it's basically this extension detected that there are quite a few scripts, in fact, a lot of scripts here, that are not being cached, or like scripts that are being cached for 10 seconds. That's pretty much useless. 1 hour, 2 hours, maybe those could be extended, right? Combine images, so there's a lot of small files up here. For example, this serve images resources, optimize images. So here's an interesting one, right? So we detected that a lot of images, this is my favorite one, are not saved in the optimal format. For example, this guy, news divider. Let me click on that. You guys see it? No? No? If I make it bigger, maybe?
No, you can see it. It's actually like a 3 1 pixel wide break image.
And that file is 45 kilobytes. It is 45 kilobytes. If you save it in the proper, in a reasonable format, not in PNG, this file can be 99% less bytes. The fact that you're serving a static line border as an image is a different problem. You know, so we actually even give you the optimized version. If you click on this link, we'll give you the optimized PNG, so you can just save that, like right-click, save as, overwrite your bad file, and be done with it, right? But this is the kind of things that this tool will catch for you and give you recommendations. And you can go through all the rules. We have a lot of good documentation for, like, what if you don't know what deferred JavaScript means, you can click and learn more, right? So this is the PageSpeed extension. Definitely a good tool to have. Just kind of think of it as like a linter, right? A rule engine for your code. But at this point, you know, if you pause and say like, hey, if we've detected all these problems for you, and we even optimize this image for you, and we're giving it to you, can we just automate all of this, right? And that's where PageSpeed and one PageSpeed communities within your application. So I'll hand over to Josh.
Certainly it is worse. Let's take another view of what this looks like from a timeline perspective. Actually, by the way, I'm Josh Marantz. I work on PageSpeed optimization tools. So this includes my PageSpeed, which is an Apache module that automatically makes websites faster, Nginx PageSpeed to Nginx PageSpeed Service, which is the same thing. Accelerating content all basically the same thing, three different delivery methods. Usually before we try to optimize something, we try to see where we are. And we are have a lot of white. I'm kind of scrolling through a thumbnail view. Who here has used web page test? Who here has heard of web page test? Web page test is awesome. WebPageTest is it was actually created at AOL, and then the guy that built it left AOL, took the tool with me and resourced it. And now it's at Google and all kinds of stuff. So basically what it does is it helps you see in detail the performance of your site as viewed from other places using any browser you want. So it's got instances all over the world, Singapore and Dublin and Virginia and all over, and you can see what your site looks like. You can say, what does my site look like from Dublin on Firefox 6 at DSL speeds? And you can kind of tweak the speeds with that. And one of the user agents that supports an iPhone, so this iPhone. So in 8 seconds, we see kind of the outline of what's going on. And I don't know why it drew a yellow box around this one. I don't actually remember what that means. Actually, if you see this on a bigger monitor, it's a little bit easier to understand. But see, the red line shows you kind of where you are on the timeline relative to the waterfall. So if I can scroll, I can't scroll that. So we don't have to see all of it, but it considers that green line a point of interest as far as I can tell. It doesn't look quite different. The big problem on the site is that there's a huge number of images, and I don't see that many images. So I'm kind of confused as to why there's so many images on the site. And then only at 12 seconds, everything says, ah, here you go. And basically, what we have here, I have to admit, I don't have a lot of experience using this tool to debug a mobile profile, but it seems like it's really bandwidth limited. I also don't understand why iPhone is doing all of these simultaneous effects. Usually you have a maximum number of simultaneous connections as 6. So as far as I can tell, there's a whole bunch of images, only a few of them actually are visible, and they're all fighting each other to get onto the phone at the same time. And I suppose that maybe these are images which are downloaded into the DOM that are not visible yet, that interact with the phone over here. And maybe some of you play with the site, and you know, it's kind of like a revolving a photo show or something like that. But this is a case where clearly, if we kind of, like I said, let's try to get the visible content onto the device first. The experience would be dramatically better. This particular issue is not something that PageSpeed or PageSpeed will currently do automatically, but it's something that, you know, looking at that, makes me want to think about how to do that. But taking a little bit more of a look at the detail, the waterfall graph, there's just a huge amount of stuff. These images actually aren't that big. This one is, for example, 113K. Actually, that's pretty big. I bet it doesn't need to be that big for this display on the phone. 116K, that's the entire image on the phone. So this is what the tools that I will can help with a lot today. And it doesn't really, to be honest, matter that much whether it's desktop or mobile. Almost all images on the web are like 5x bigger than they need to be. And that basically is translates directly to the user experience. And this one is no exception. And I can kind of feed on itself because there are more images that need attention.
Let's go to the slide of the user.
So automated tools can help a lot with this. They can't solve all the problems, but they can give you a leg up. Why aren't all websites fast? There's usually a strong desire at any particular website development effort to kind of make value that is unique to the website. The experience compelling, a certain business need. Paying attention to all the web performance best practices is often not high on the agenda. And I would kind of argue that it shouldn't be. I think that to the largest extent possible, we should utilize tools for this. I spend most of my days writing C++ code and working with people that do that. I don't really worry about registrar allocation. It's just not something that I ever want to think about. I don't understand why people want to think too much about web performance best practices if you can get a compiler to do it automatically. Now, I'm the first to admit that we are not as mature in the web performance optimization world as compilers are now, but we're getting better at it. We can take more and more of the burden off the Union submanual. But we can offer a lot of value for basically the cost of download and install. You can do inlining of resources, extended cache lifetime, you can compress images, you can exploit features in modern browsers when the user is in modern browsers, but deliver a functional experience to native browsers at the same time without changing the website. These are all things that are painful to bake in. A64 encoding the common images, taking advantage of HTML5 features for local support. These are all things that you can do yourself, but it's a lot of development effort. And it's attention, because the more of that stuff that you do, the more register allocation type of in C++ code, the less room there is for actual content that you put on top of it. So I don't do register allocations. So the solution to this tension between speed and ease of use is to use environment-based version control. So mod pinch speed is kind of the first tool, so most people talk about it. Actually, let me just take a quick poll. How many people here run websites? Well, those that run web servers, how many use Apache? How many use Nginx? How many use something else?
What do you use?
I don't
know.
Are you sure it's not Apache or Nginx?
Oh, no, it's Apache. Oh, okay.
Cool. Our first productization of this technology was on Apache, and we've recently released an alpha version of Nginx, which should be exactly Nginx. It's ready to try out, experiment with, wait till we get the data, and get some serious load testing before we put it in production. ModPageSpeed is in full stable release. It's kind of like a stable channel. Chrome does, in addition to beta channel. So if you go to modpagespeed.com, it will show you all of the things that modpagespeed can do automatically to your site. If you go to nginxpagespeed.com, it does the same thing. It's almost identical. There's like one feature that's the same thing that we'll throw that in. So we released modpagespeed about 2.5 years ago, and it is it was quickly picked up by a couple of hosting providers. Dreamhost and GoDaddy, content builder called EdgeCast, released. So in that productization, you don't have to anything to your own server, but EdgeCast can accelerate your content at the edge, which is pretty compelling itself. Last October, we launched 1.0 with a stable channel and kind of spurred adoption over 200,000 site reaction. So quite a few sites. There are more and more we are. So almost everything that ModPageSpeed does is equally applicable to mobile and desktop, but we're working on adding more and more mobile specific features to it as well. But anything that you can do to speed up the site on desktop will benefit mobile as well. These are the kind of videos that are produced by PageCast. Basically slow and fast. How does it do that? Who here has not seen a water outlet? Okay. So basically, you don't even have to look too deeply at the waterfall diagram to see the impact. If you have a highly, a site that's been highly optimized, if you go to, say, yahoo.com, there's some serious performance engineers that spend all of their days leaking every little byte out of that site. And ModPageSpeed won't do pretty much anything to that site, except maybe slow it down to a site that doesn't have to come from you. Almost every other site that would usually find a huge amount of unnecessary bytes to trim out images, of small things that can inline, of multiple resources that can combine together, to basically make the picture much shorter and thinner. And it's just always good when you do that. That's kind of the first order. The second order of things that it does is try to rearrange resources so that the browser can deliver them more effectively to the user. But that's harder, a little bit harder to see on the waterfall.
How does it work? The core of the system is a set of C++ libraries called the PageSpeed Optimization Library. It's a server-independent optimization framework that parses HTML, optimizes images, rewrites CSS and JavaScript. It does all this kind of asynchronously in the background so that user requests are never delayed. We'd rather deliver unoptimized content than wait for force the client to wait for us to optimize the image, for example. Then there's a bunch of gaskets that connect the PageSpeed optimization libraries to particular services. Question?
Yes, as you go along with this, I mean, there's been a lot of talk about what Amazon has done for Kindle. Can you contrast this approach with what they're doing, you know, how it differs?
Sure. I think that there's probably quite a bit of overlap. We're talking about the Silk browser in Firefox, right? There's a lot of overlap. I don't know very much about where they are with that. Have you used, do you have a Kindle Fire?
No.
Who has a Kindle Fire? And there's a, you can switch the mode whether you're going to proxy content through, or do you keep that mode on or do you turn it off?
I don't know.
I'm just curious. I haven't heard a lot of success about that, but I think it's just kind of a different way of packaging the technology.
Yeah, it's a slightly different use case, right? So in one case, you're using a mobile. You're saying I, the user, will install a browser which will proxy all the data from some service and make it faster, whatever that may be. In fact, most of the gains that Silk does is convert all images to WebP, to a different image format, which has significant savings on the wire, which is what makes it faster. But you know, as a site owner, you can't expect every user to install Silk, right? So that's not an answer. If you're thinking about like, how to make my website fast, you can't count on the user to rely on this proxy. So these are being deployed at kind of different ends. One is me saying as a user, I want the faster web as a whole. That's why I'm going to use this proxy solution. Another good example is Opera Turbo. Right? I use it on that mode in Opera, and it will do the same thing. Whereas what we're talking about here is we want to make our site, the site that we operate, faster for everybody that comes to us.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's who's making the optimization decision, the user or the site? Another thing that I believe that Silk does is it proxies all content through an intermediary that's sitting in Amazon Cloud, which means that that's doing all the DNS resolution, and that's good. You can actually do that with MyPageSpeed as well. You can put MyPageSpeed on a proxy into the Amazon EC2 instance, and there was a great blog post about doing exactly that a year ago. MyPageSpeed as a proxy for your phone. It's an awesome post. I had never even thought of doing that, but it works really well. The advantage is that you're really only resolving one DNS address on your phone. And then when you build a computer, you all, you know, basically you funnel the rest of the traffic or collects it and sends it to your phone. In addition to that, you do all the optimizations, converting images and customers, and so on. So MyPageSpeed is basically the PageSpeed optimization libraries, which has about 40 different optimizations built into it. Probably about 3 or 4 of them are specific to mobile, but even the ones that are not benefit mobile. And there's a connection to Apache. There's another gasket that connects it to NGINX.
there's a third option as well, which is Google has a service which kind of acts as an accelerated content delivery network, where basically the same technology is used to accelerate the content served from serve your site from Google's network. That's called PageSpeed Service. So there's about 40 different optimizations. Probably about a third of them are considered core, and so when you install the module, they're on by default. The rest of them are considered riskier, some very high benefit. A great example is deferred JavaScript. Basically, when there is JavaScript in the head, especially jQuery, the first thing that the browser will do is, when it sees that, is it stops all rendering. Nothing else happens that's visible to the user until the DNS address is resolved, content is downloaded, first and executed. This is kind of fundamental to the way the HTML is defined. So the best thing that you can do is push all the JavaScript down to the bottom of the page. My page, you can do this automatically. It's harder than it sounds because JavaScript just is sensitive to the point in the DOM where the script tag was encountered. And so that all has to be compensated for a bunch of really hairy logic. So it can be extremely impactful. It can make pages three times faster to turn on deferred JavaScript, and you have to make sure that you like the behavior that you get. For most of the core filters, particularly rewriting images, they're extremely safe. Putting them on will almost always work on sites. There are exceptions, but we feel like it's 200,000 sites can reasonably happy with the choices that we made about what filters are core filters, and if they're not, you can disable individual optimizations or blacklist particular URLs that you don't want to optimize. A question? I don't know about Angular in particular. It's been tested. It has a lot of mileage on it, and it doesn't all do that. So,
I tried a number, and depends on what you're doing with them. But maybe the observation is if you do something like Angular or Ember.js or any of the big frameworks, where you're literally building the big JavaScript, the Ember.js is not going to, it's not the best fit, right? Ember.js is ideal for content where you have a bunch of social links or a bunch of like additional click handlers or other things which are not critical to paint the screen. The actual content is constructed by the actual small element.
So you might have just answered this, but I couldn't hear exactly the question, but you're talking about using Node to pre-process the page before pushing that out? Is that the question you were answering? I was just seeing how that compared to this solution.
No, so this is slightly different. So when you say pre-process the page, what do you mean?
Yeah, just using Node to pre-process the page before it gets sent out. So when you get a request, the page has already been pre-processed and he's just sending out HTML.
Oh, I see. So you're saying that instead of just relying on JavaScript constructing the page, you could actually, let's say you have a templating, JavaScript templating engine, it is actually a good practice or best practice to render that template first on the server, right? Write up HTML, send HTML, because the browser is very efficient at constructing a page and making it visible, and then you fill in and add all of the additional hooks to make that page respond. The best example of this is, I'm going to pick on Twitter. If you guys remember, they fixed the problem now, but maybe 6 months ago, they had the experience where you come to the page and you get the head of the page, kind of an empty frame, and then you kind of sit there for a few seconds on a bad day, and you're like, what's going on, what's going on, and then all of a sudden everything pops in. Right? That's because JavaScript would be constructing the page and then everything's painted. They changed this now such that they pre-render the page first in the server, they push the HTML so everything's visible, and then JavaScript picks up. So that is certainly a very good pattern. It's a little tricky, right, because you need to be able to render the same templates on the server and on the client, but it is doable.
Yeah, there are packages that just do all that for you, that pre-render the page for you.
Exactly.
So I've seen 5 or 6 times faster renders.
Yeah, absolutely. So in fact, Twitter posted a really good kind of post-mortem on this whole thing that they did. If you just go on their open source blog, or just on their development blog, and just search for rendering speed or something like that, this is maybe 6 months old or so.
Have you been able to do analytics between the two and compare like rendering speed ups or?
They did provide that data, and it's dramatic. I can tell you that it's super confusing. It was dramatic.
So, the basic idea is that when you use an automated tool, you don't have to kind of redesign your content generation flow for best practice. You just let a tool do that for you.
Excuse me, can you repeat that?
The bottom line is using automated web performance optimization tools, which MyPageSpeed is an example. There's also automated tools from Akamai, Limelight, Exchange, and a few other companies. The basic idea is rather than having to do all these steps manually, a resource combining part of your build flow, a script that runs through all your images and crushes them down. There's advantages to having a tool to do that for you. One of them is that it's easier. Another one is that the tool can actually be sensitive to the browser. So these are things that you, so this is just a list of things that you don't need to do if you use an automated tool to do it for you.
Does Google have an idea of how many people actually handcraft pages versus use the systems you're talking about?
Almost all pages on the web are still handcrafted.
Right. So.
or actually, I should say that a lot of them are generated with content management systems like WordPress. So, not quite handcrafted.
So I have a question. Is part of Google's strategy to build an IDE that actually kills some of these issues up front, rather than just have optimization tools?
These two are actually very much related. Right, so for example, take a typical workflow with something like WordPress. Right, this is a very common problem today. I have an awesome catalog. I take another picture with my awesome 8 megapixel camera. I grab that photo, happens to be 4.5 megs. I drop it into a folder, I upload it, I resize it in my WYSIWYG editor, and I press post. Guess what? WordPress does no image resizing. So you're going to be looking at a small 400 by 400 pixel image of my awesome cat, downloading the full 4.5 megabytes in all its glory, right? So this is an IDE, right? This is how people create content today. It's how people author content. And what I don't think people like Google, I don't think we should strive to educate all people about web performance.
I didn't say that, right? I'm talking about professional IDE. So you're talking about professional sites, I imagine. I'm not talking about WordPress where people are, who are not professionals and are just posting their stuff. So what I'm hearing is that Google doesn't have the strategy of doing anything up front. It's focusing on back-end optimization or back-end workflow optimization.
Maybe sort of. So let me try a different take. So if you have a focused development team, right, or a development team that's focused on the front end, a lot of these things are best practices that are already well known and kind of established in your build process, in your design process, and all the rest. So as engineers, like we have teams on every major product within Google that are thinking about performance, we're always measuring performance. And our designers and engineers are aware of these best practices. So we can instill these best practices in just like when we generate this content. But then for the rest of the web, you know, when you hand over the keys for the awesome site that you build, WordPress or not, users are not thinking about these things. And that's where we need automation. But even on our site, right, we not want to waste our cycles, as Josh said. Like, I don't want to care about what is the optimal image format. Like, I care about web performance, but on my blog, I use my PageSpeed or PageSpeed Service. I've stopped caring about what is the optimal image format. I just save everything as a PNG, because I don't care, and then the server optimizes all the images for me. It's beautiful. I don't have to worry about it.
Most mobile, this is my last comment. Most people who are building mobile apps in HTML5 that I know are handcrafting them. They're not using tools, and they're professionals, and they're doing these for companies.
Yeah.
So what you're saying makes sense, of course. You learn through practice. But it's interesting to me that Google is putting so much money and time and attention into optimizing when there could be something that's done in the upfront for people who tend to handcraft, which is a significant professional body. It just seems like there's that aspect is missing.
So we don't have some like grand master plan for it, one IDE to rule them all, right? We have Emacs, which is
could, I'd like to keep the rest of the questions until the end and let the presentation finish, just because it'll work a little bit smoother that way. So, sorry.
I would like to make another comment there. So an IEE is kind of like the grand master plan of everything coming here, and I'll sort it out for you. But there's also a bunch of practicals that are part of the flow. And as an alternative to using my page, there's PNG Crush, there's tweaking your stuff and Photoshop. There's Google has released a JavaScript optimizing compiler called Closure Compiler. There's equivalent things for CSS. So there are technologies created by Google and by others to do all of the things individually that MyPageSpeed does. MyPageSpeed is just kind of a drop-in solution that does it automatically and dynamically. Whether you do it dynamically as you're serving the content or in the content construction phase using point tools or using an IDE, we're good with all of it. Whatever sticks. So far, we've seen that MyPageSpeed seems to stick. People are going to try it. People adopt. The adoption is growing over time. But it seems like we're not doing half the web yet. I would like to be doing half the web.
Right.
Let's move forward. So let's look at a couple of things that MyPageSpeed does. Remember I said that there were core filters and more aggressive filters. The core filters kind of come on by default when you install the software. This is one here that kind of C++ studio code for the filter that collapses white space out of an HTML file. Why would you want to collapse white space? It's the box model. It's true also that gzip makes the transfer size smaller, which is most of the problem. Although it is still kind of nice that when it comes back into the browser and you gmzip it, that it winds up being smaller, so there's less bytes in the browser. So we do have a filter there. It basically registers. So the way that MyPageSpeed works is that it parses HTML into tokens, and it sends tokens to filters that have registered interest in certain events, like a character's event or a open tab event or so on and so on. So collapsed white space basically only cares about character's events. When you get a character, a block of characters, it basically says, let's just replace all of the consecutive white spaces with a single white space, but only if we're not in a pre-tag. Because if you're in a pre-tag, then white space is significant. It turns out that this filter is actually a little bit riskier than it sounds, because there's more than just pre-tags. There's a few different CSS styles that if applied to a node can make white space significant and make this break pages. We don't ever want to break pages. So we can't detect all of them by looking at HTML. Some of these styles can be applied by JavaScript or by external CSS. And for this reason, this is not a core filter. This is a filter that's reasonably popular and lots of people turn it on. But if you dynamically apply a style that makes white space significant, this filter breaks your setup. So it's not a core filter. And it's not kind of a first, this doesn't have nearly the impact of compressing images. Compressing images is by far more important than moving white space. The next example is combining multiple CSS files. If you have a bunch of small CSS files, each one of those is a round trip that with a lot of overhead setting, HTTP requests and round trips and so on. So this basically rips through HTML looking for references to CSS files, and basically concatenates the references together into a large URL, which combines the names of, kind of factors out the common prefix.
Styles.
Rather than four different CSS files, it'll have one with yellow.css plus blue.css. Then it signs its own name, PageSpeed, into the URL. So if something goes wrong, you can blame us. CC is a code. This is actually has a lot of significance. It's combined CSS. And then the most important thing is this hash. This is the MD5 sum of the combined contents of the four CSS files.
And what this means by putting this into the URL is that we can serve this file with a 1-year cache lifetime, actually an arbitrarily large cache lifetime. And if any of the input files change, it doesn't matter. We won't serve stale content to the browser because we will wind up changing the name of this URL because this MD5 symbol will change. So it's a way of kind of having invested both worlds. You can basically be extremely agile with pushing changes out to all of your users, but essentially have infinite cacheability in browsers. And what happens when you change one of these CSS files is we'll start serving HTML that references a new URL, and the old URLs that are the old versions of this file that are in browser caches don't matter. We'll never ask them again. So basically, every resource optimization that MyPageSpeed does, it signs the URL with the MD5 sign and serves it with infinite cache lifetime. This helps both repeat views, which might not be that important, but also helps you as you navigate around the site because a lot of the resources are common. Next, let's look at image reset, or image compression. This is probably the most impactful thing that we do. Again, we're going to talk about our awesome cat photo if you have a camera and download it at high resolution. The first request for this awesome cat, MyPageSpeed will probably not deliver an optimized result because MyPageSpeed does not kind of proactively go through your site and optimize everything. On demand, it sees, oh, somebody wants to see this awesome cat picture. Let me go off and fetch it and start an optimization flow where we will create a resized JPEG version for JPEG compatible browsers, a resized WebP version for WebP compatible browsers, and store all of these in a server-side cache so that the next time somebody goes and looks at this HTML file, we'll be delivering the optimized image that's appropriate for the browser. So this is not something that you can completely do statically on a site. You can't just take a static engine and transform it to deliver the best possible experience because if you're mobile, you probably care at least about iPhone and Android. And if you're delivering content to an iPhone, it better be JPEG. You should use WebP because it's about 30% smaller for the same quality. You want to inject that logic into your servers, then you just install MyPageSpeed to figure it out. So this is doing a few things. It's taking this original PNG and converting it to either JPEG or WebP. Either one is much better than PNG for a photo. And it's also taking into account the context in which this image is displayed, which is that we only want 800 pixels. It might be 8,000 by 8,000 coming out of the camera, but we only want 800 pixels of it showing up on the actual screen, probably for mobile significantly less. So we'll do that image resize down both to convert from ping to lossy format, and also for the width, and optionally, if you allow us to do lossy compression, which we don't do in MyPageSpeed by default, then we'll compress to say JPEG 85, it'll be much, much smaller for the same visible occurrence. Again, just like the combined CSS, the entire recipe of what went into optimizing this this file, it's put into the URL, and this is done for reasons that if somebody grabs this URL and sends it to a MyPageSpeed server that has a completely clear cache, we need to be able to reconstruct the original resource. Who here knows what SPDY is? We should probably mention what SPDY is. Who here knows what SPDY is?
Yeah, so for those who haven't heard of SPDY before, it's a new protocol that sort of augments HTTP. It started sort of as an experiment at Google that has been gaining traction And actually, the ITF is using it as a starting point for their development of HTTP 2.0. So SPDY is now supported by Chrome, Firefox, Opera. So we should sort of be thinking, if you add SPDY support to your server, that is going to basically instantly speed up your site for over half of your users in terms of browser share. So there's support for SPDY in Apache using mod SPDY, which I wrote. There's also support in Nginx and Node.js and Jetty and other places. So if you're running the server, I would look into whatever server you're using, see if you can try out SPDY support and see if that's something that works for your site. So basically what SPDY does is it adds an extra layer in between HTTP and TCP. That gives you the sort of multiplexing layer and it compresses all HTTP headers into a few other things. And so basically it sort of takes care of, not all, but some of the sort of web performance optimizations basically just gets taken care of at the protocol layer. So for example, Josh talked about combining CSS, which is something that PageSpeed can do automatically for you, and say HTTP requests, but if you're using SPDY, you sort of don't need to do that, because SPDY's multiplexing sort of gets rid of all that overhead, and having extra requests is not something very cheap. And certain other optimizations that you either have to do by hand or get something like PageSpeed for you, if you're using SPDY, basically don't matter anymore. So I guess in the interest of time, that's all I'll say. But again, if I would look into this, if you're running Apache or Nginx or Node.js or one of these other things, I would look at this and see if it's appropriate for your site.
Just mentioned Android supports SPDY and
so Android also supports SPDY. So there's lots of clients and row support for SPDY. So this is basically a couple of flags in your Apache configuration file that you have to worry about the rest, which is quite beautiful. So with that, we have a little bit of time for questions. I mean, we're a little bit over time already. Yes. And a microphone.
Yeah.
Can we sit there? That's what we need.
So just don't do the CSS combining. You can turn off that filter entirely and configure it for your site. So I actually wouldn't change anything in what we're doing.
Is the same issue around the PNGs with caching?
No, so for PNGs it should be fine. So if we take an image server, let's take this awesome cat image, right? We would actually rewrite the URL to be something like this, such that if you change the file later, this URL would also change. Now, there's a different case which we didn't talk about here, which is we do a lot of work with images. One of them is image spreading. How many people here like doing image spreading? Really? You guys are lying. Yeah, in a perverse way, I guess. So it's a terrible thing, right? Like, it sucks that you have to do this. I remember sitting in a Photoshop file and lining up my freaking things on a grid. It's a disaster. So nowadays we have some new better automation tools that will do that. Mod PageSpeed will do that for you. We will actually detect that you have a lot of small images. We will build a PNG, a larger or whatever format is optimal. We'll build the image for you and we'll write the CSS for you and we'll do the right thing. So we'll do image spreading for you on the fly, which is beautiful.
Is
this the server side that you're writing fully well with all the settings and responsive design? So how does this play with responsive design? Yes and no. So the yes and no is, if you have a CSS, collection of CSS files, right, or different CSS files, which are referencing images through the URL field in CSS, we will also scan CSS and rewrite those images or optimize those images. Now, what we may not do, actually we won't do in that case, is resize them, because we don't really know the size. So the only cases where we will resize the image on the server is either if you provide explicit markup in HTML, like this, or if you have an inline style here, if you have a style something, right? And this pattern is actually, I'll just point out, this is actually incredibly useful for a lot of cases where you have an asset, let's say a large asset, and then you want to reuse that asset in a variety of different sizes, scales, for maybe a mobile site, and then a tablet site, and something else, right? On my desktop, it will be, my awesome cat is 800 pixels wide, but on my phone, it's 400 pixels wide. By sticking this value into your markup, you don't have to worry about resizing the image. You just have the one original asset living on your server, and then Mod PageSpeed will do the rest. It will actually deliver the appropriate image file. Does your host start with Dreamhost or?
No.
So, if you can't configure your server, then we can't really help you that much with Mod PageSpeed. Maybe PageSpeed Service. So that's a hosted service by Google, which will basically, it uses all the same infrastructure, but it's a proxy through Google. So take a look at that. But you know, coming back to the shared hosting environment, GoDaddy, Dreamhost, and a bunch of other hosting providers that we're working with have it as an option. In many cases, it's not enabled. It's like a turbo button, right? You just have to like check the box that says, make it go fast. And really what they're doing under the hood is that they're dropping an HTTP access file that says, turn on PageSpeed. And yeah, that's it.
GoDaddy
has
PageSpeed on all
of
their servers, you just have to
do
it.
Yep.
So a lot of this is about optimizing your resources and finding them but as you said, it's on a per-site basis. I wonder if you have looked at how many of these resources are actually shared across a wide range of sites because they're coming out some standard tools or something like that, and whether some of this optimization can be done such that a lot of sites can be referencing commonly managed resources.
Yep, so we do have some work for some of that. For example, jQuery is a good example, right? Lots of people use jQuery, some people use it off the Google CDN or like jQuery CDN, and some people just download their copy. So we actually have an additional filter which you can enable that will check your local copy of jQuery and then rewrite it to the Google CDN. And the reason you want to do that is lots of people use the Google CDN version, and chances are it's already in their cache, right? So that's one less download. So that's a great example of what you're describing. So we're starting to look at that. jQuery is, I think, the first example. Maybe we can do more of it. That's a great question. So when we create these URLs, how do we make sure that you know these are not don't go over the limit of some mobile gateways? Like there's some funky cases where some gateways will cut off URLs over, I think, 1024. I would like to know which gateway you're using. Do you send one like when you get to the test? no, that's fascinating. Actually, I'd love to learn more. We have not run into edge cases with this. Really, you know, this is about the extent of what we add. The hash itself is another, you know, whatever, 16 characters. 10. Yeah, 10 characters. So hopefully we're not going to blow the URL too much, but I'd love to know more.
We definitely run it. This is a real limitation for combiners, because combiners have to keep the names of all the things that they're combining. And there are some limitations, and some flows through Apache and proxy servers, but we're conscious of. We have a settable pointer for how long we'll make a URL setting. I think it's 250. But it's an option that you can set. I wasn't aware that anybody limited it to 80. If you're limited to 80, maybe we should just change that to 80. What will end up happening is we'll make more combinations with fewer files. So it's kind of naturally we can deal with that. But I'm not too worried about that.
So maybe a few more things worth mentioning. We have special parameters which you can put on JavaScript files and on images that basically say, hey, you know, even though I told you to combine or optimize images, don't do that for this file. So if you have specific edge cases and you're like, just don't touch this, we have specific parameters that can do that. So that's handy. We also have a lot of configuration around, for example, we can do automatic inlining of files for you. Or anybody ever put a base64 image into their HTML? Yay, that was fun, right? We can do that for you. We actually have a limit that says, you know, any file that's under 2 kilobytes, and this is configurable, you can change this to be anything you want, just inline it into the page. Right? And this is kind of a trade-off that you need to make, because if you have the same image repeated on every single page, you're bloating every single page. But sometimes the overhead of making that request is just so much higher. So you don't have to worry about image spreading, inline, base64 inlining your images, optimizing your images. There's a lot of gates we have there.
Yeah, so I actually have two questions. One, you were talking a little bit about how accessible SPDY is on mobile browsers. I think you said one of the browsers had it. We know what the ramp up is for SPDY being available?
So Chrome and Android and Chrome and iOS both support SPDY.
So Android has it on the latest, or is it?
So all the Chromes, all recent Firefoxes, all recent operators, including the version code, should all support SPDY. The default Android browser, for some reason, you're still using that, and it also supports it. The big ones that don't are Internet Explorer and Safari.
Do you know when that's coming?
I don't know. It's quite possible that they won't bother to support it until it's standard.
I had one more question. Do you have metrics on server load when you add this, in terms of server resources that you need extra when you add these in?
Yeah, I can speak to that. So there's two cases to consider. If you have a mobile, an image-rich site, when you first bring it up, the server-side cache is cold. It will start going through a process of optimizing that image, but it's going to do it using only a bounded amount of load. As to your serving, it's a settable point for how many visual requests do I want to do at once. The default is 4. And once everything's in cache, there should be no more imagery writing going on until you add an image to your site. And the ongoing expense will be basically tokenizing the HTML, which is approximately 10 milliseconds of CPU time per request.
Oh. Yep, thanks.
Is there any way to get things into the cache without someone being the site or leaving that image or you know where you're
yeah. I'm gonna get on your site then. No, seriously, I think that's I suggest for people that want to keep their cache form that they have like a not off the use site. Just have to get in contact. Have you get cache people.
Which is the same as the free world.
Two questions about site speed. First one is that built on the HTML file and have additional timing API?
So the Google Analytics site speed reports, yes. So that uses navigation timing. The Google Analytics tracker just grabs the data out of the browser and beacons it alongside the other Google Analytics data.
Okay, my second question is a separate request from analytics or
so it depends on how you're implemented your tracker. Sometimes you can piggyback on the same request, sometimes it may come out as a different request.
One point, we didn't get to this in the presentation, but my PageSpeed can drive experiments through the Google Analytics framework. You can set up in your PageSpeed.com file, let's say I want to send half of my traffic, say through my PageSpeed, half of it not, to see what the benefit is, and then you can look, you associate that with your Google Analytics ID, and then you can go and see how much faster you actually make your stuff to users. It's always good to start off with web page tests to see, you know, directly, just measure it yourself, but that isn't reflective of what real user behavior actually mean in that in the model, so it's good to be really user.
So the one tip for Google Analytics is maybe after this, you know, you'll want to do Google Analytics is search for site speed sampling rate. And there's this one line that you need to put into your configuration of or your snippet when you set up your Google Analytics, which basically raises the sampling rate from the default of 1% to whatever you want. We have a maximum of 10,000 visits per day or samples that we will record. So for example, for my site, my personal blog, you know, I don't get 10,000 visits per day, so I just sample 100%, which gives me a lot of useful data. So this is a common complaint that I hear from people when they log into SiteSpeed. They're like, "Well, there's not much data." I'm like, "Well, yeah, just go raise your limit, and then you know, give it a week, and you'll be in very good shape." Because then you can use the full power of Google Analytics to create segments, correlate your speed metrics with e-commerce transactions or conversions, whatever you're using Google Analytics for. To do your part of validation.
You presented information on the customer expectation for response time and how they respond to that. My guess is that's web data. Are you aware of any mobile studies along those lines?
Right, so has not really been replicated in mobile. So I'm not aware of any specific mobile studies. I don't see any. So in fact, these numbers have held true from the early 90s. These, you know, a lot of these studies go back to just basic UI and UX research in like what makes a good user interface on a computer. And surprisingly, you know, over the last decade, these results have been repeated and the same numbers are coming out. So I'm not aware of any specific, like on mobile or on Android, you know, these are the numbers, but I wouldn't expect them to change at all. In fact, when we poll users in general, they expect the web to be just as fast, if not faster, on mobile. And that's the expectation of users coming in. We explicitly ask this question, and there's no expectation of the web being slower, right? Nobody's told us that yet.
For speed, does that question happen after SSL?
It happens during the SSL action. Let's see, actually, that's the caveat that I forgot to mention. For the reasons that we want to ask later, speed only operates over SSL. So if your site has no SSL component, then I'm sorry, there's no SSL. But because it happens during the SSL action, that goes into the current SSL.
So you mentioned earlier that DNS and SSL was taking a long time.
Yep.
Right? I mean, a huge percent of the time. What are you doing about that?
What are we doing about that? So we have, let's see, the Google DNS service, which you can use, it's free, actually. So that's one. We have, for TCP, there's a bunch of improvements that we have in the works. So for example, we've recently submitted patches, and they're part of the Linux kernel now for increasing the congestion window size by default. There's research into a thing called TCP Fast Open, which is instead of doing having to do a full round trip, you can actually send the request data as part of the SYN packet. So there's a lot of work in progress, and then actually the TFO, which is TCP Fast Open, has recently landed in the Linux kernel. So we're just waiting for client supports to ship as well. So there's a lot of work in there in progress. And we have a whole number of proposals for SSL as well for how to reduce the number of round trips. So unfortunately, these pieces do take a bunch of time to deploy. Right? We're talking about standardizing this, going through IETF, getting that approved, getting that to Linux kernel, and then getting all of you guys to update your servers. So you know, the real release cycle on this kind of thing is measured in years, maybe you know, half a decade. But I think we're moving in the right direction.
Is it good time to share some of the slides here?
Yes, we'll make the slides available right after.
Yeah,
awesome.
Okay.
All right, well, thank you guys.
Okay, I think the next meeting is on the 25th of next month. So see you then. Thanks for coming out tonight.